first lecture is on diodes, and as I said, the I'm sure all of you must have been teaching this course sometime or the other, and the I was also not sure what to put, okay. And in an hour, typically kind of our lectures at your place, I'm sure at our place also it's 1 hour, and we roughly have as teachers an idea how much you can, how many slides you need or how many pages you need to cover in a 1 hour lecture, and I have much more than that, okay. So the purpose is not to cover all this, but you know, kind of interact. So please stop me, please feel free to stop me, maybe show your hand, or please, please do that, you know. If any class and I don't get questions, you know, I get extremely bored, and I always feel something is wrong, okay, especially something is wrong with me, that's why people are not reacting. Yeah. Now, as I said, the main purpose of this particular course itself is to decide on kind of syllabus, is one aspect, but the other aspect is to kind of jointly learn from each other, you know, how to teach. And unfortunately, I am sure none of you would have had a training in teaching like a B.Ed. course, you know. We are all launched as teachers from day one, and we are expected to learn the art, you know, while swimming itself we are supposed to learn. And so therefore, I am sure we all have different experiences, and based on my own experiences, I can say some things which have helped, as I was sharing earlier also. I was teaching at IIT Kanpur for last 17 years. I have just come on a visiting position here for 2 years. Now, I taught this particular course several times. I mean, I have taught this in Kanpur. We had at that time a strength of about 200 students. So, one shot we had to teach 200 students, and it had a lab component also. That I taught about 2 times, and I have been involved for last 17 years, every semester or every year in the either in the lab or somewhere I was involved. At IIT Bombay also, last semester I taught a similar course, very similar for 120 students. So, as you know, in IITs also the number of students are now very large. So, we have anywhere from 600 to 800 students at a time. So, we teach in about 5 separate sessions. So, I taught one such class. But here at IIT Bombay, we do not have the lab also along with the course, that is the main difference, and there is a separate lab, whereas at Kanpur we had that integrated with the course. Yeah. Now, coming back to diodes, so when I quickly go through, I also want to share some of my experiences with my own students, okay. And I find that students are the same, whether it is Kanpur, whether it is Bombay, students are students, okay, no difference. And they may be a little bit, maybe you know, the city makes some difference, but I think otherwise students are always students. So, I am sure you would have the same experience. Now, I am sure you are all from different parts of India. One of the basic problem in teaching a course like basic electronics is what? What is the problem? Some of the problems you have faced. So, one of the problems I faced is that at least some students would say that we know it, okay. At least I had one student, he said I am bored, I do not want to attend your classes, don't attend, no problem. But at the same time, you would have another set of students saying, no, no, we do not know anything, assume nothing. I had some, most of the time even here also students said, sir, assume nothing, start from scratch, okay. At the same time, you have 50% students saying, no, no, we know all this from our boards. So, we have this problem in our country, again we cannot complain, we have to solve the problem, okay. For example, some state boards might have, especially if you look at CBSE, they taught everything. Basic electronics course is over. If you have 12 standard physics books with you, and if somebody understood, then do not have, but we know that it has been taught so bad or they are so confused. So, that is where you have to undo some of the damages, okay. Or some state boards fortunately have not taught them, okay, and then you have an advantage, you can teach them. So, I think I am sure you have all this. So, one of the things I always found, as I said, and I found this universal, last 17 years of experience I can say this. And I found it every time, one part which students always appreciate, that is they want to see things, okay. And I am sure all of us also appreciate it. So, always make it a point to, and I have not done it today because you are teachers, I don't, should not teach you like, treat you like kids. Always bring components to the class, okay, diodes, and they would like to see, touch it, okay. In fact, it is not a bad idea to burn some of them, you know, they should see. When you say diode characteristics, you know, they should understand what it means by a diode characteristics. Now, when you talk about diodes, it is one of the most basic electronic device, and this is something fortunately most of them know about it. So, we do not need to talk much about diodes, but what is more important is we need to dwell on the applications and also how they, how it is used. So, one of the most important concept to a concept wise, I found one of the most important things for students is that they need to figure out that diode is a two terminal device. And the moment you say a two terminal device, you are automatically saying that it is a single port device, okay, the concept of port, because later we will talk about two port devices. So, they need to know this word, you know, two port, single port. So, any two terminal device, now the important thing about a two terminal device is it is completely characterized by one equation, okay, which is the IV characteristics, whether it is Ohm's law, that will give you a resistance. If you have a capacitor, you have a single equation, for an inductor you have a single equation, they are all two terminal devices. So, that is a very important concept I always found it helps students tremendously, that you can say that if you get a two terminal component, take it for granted one equation is enough, a simple IV characteristics. So, I think that is the importance of the IV characteristic, you know, sometimes these things they figure, I mean they also wonder why you say IV characteristic, why not something else. So, they should know that, you know, this is a single characteristic, and if you equate them to, you show that to Ohm's law, which they are very familiar, then it makes sense. There is a current, there is a voltage. So, you are relating the voltage to the current. So, that is the importance of the diode equation. Now, coming to applications, as I said, diode fortunately is something which students generally understand well, because they have studied it and they have some idea about it. It is a very simple device also, but again what is most important is that the applications we need to, especially basic electronics course, I would say from A to Z you have to emphasize on application and show them and always try to relate to some gadget which they are familiar with and so on. Then it makes, and then they keep interest, their interest, especially basic electronics course is a course taught to everybody, okay, whether it is a civil engineer, mechanical engineer or anybody, you teach it to everybody, that is why, and it is very important. And at the same time today basic electronics course is extremely important. Why? Why is it very important today? It was maybe not so 10 years ago. Why is it so important today? Why is it very important for all engineers to know basic electronics? Why?
Electronic
application. Yeah, today you do not have a single equipment which does not have electronics, okay, not a single equipment. So, this is another reason why you need to motivate. In fact, I happen to teach always non-electrical students, always, even last semester I taught mechanical students, and that is the time it is difficult to teach them. So, I always motivate them by saying that you are very lucky, and they are very surprised why they are lucky. I said you are very lucky. I tell them that you have the most sophisticated, you people are going to handle the most sophisticated electronic equipment, and they are very happy when to hear that coming from an electric engineer. I said we are very unlucky people, they are even more happy and say we have just have three equipment, that is all we have. A CRO, a function generator and a power supply, that is all we have, and they are very happy and they laugh. But then I tell them, but we designed your equipment, and then that makes complete the story. And I think that is very important to keep them, and it is very true. Today you walk into any department, you would see that the kind of equipment which is used in other non-electrical departments are much more sophisticated than the equipment you would see in your own department. So, which is very good. Now, again when we come look at the diode equation, again one of the biggest problem today, I think it is more in IITs maybe than less at your place, that students are extremely good with maths, okay, but what they lack is what? Something else they lack. What is it? What it means, okay. And I always know in IIT system, I know it very well, if I want to trick a student, very easy. Write a question without writing an equation, just write in words, they are sunk, okay, they are sunk. Write one equation, they will solve it just like that. Do not write an equation, but write everything in words, you can just trap them completely. What I am trying to say is our present generation, unfortunately, you know, have been taught equations without telling them what it means. And here like a diode equation, you need to really tell the significance of each and every term there, and that is extremely important. And then it makes sense, you know, and that is true for engineering at you know, and that equations they have their domains. Sometimes unfortunately students are taught to think that you know theory is everything, you know, and so some of the things they must understand. And looking at the diode equation, the there are a few things which again very common mistakes both students and teachers make. For example, the diode current is related to the IS. So diode current I is equal to IS times e to the power V by VT minus 1. Now what is the relative significance where IS is the saturation current, V is the voltage across the diode, I is the current flowing through it, VT is the thermal voltage given by KT by Q. Now what is the relative significance of these two terms? That is the most important thing. Now let us look at the forward bias region. Now in the forward bias region, the first term is what is important. Now since VT is typically at room temperature is the order of 25 to 26 millivolt, and if V is about let us say 5 to 10 times VT, then you would see that even though IS is an extremely small number, typically the range somewhere from 10 power 12 to 10 power 15. We will come to that in a minute. Again a very, very common mistake made. Now because of this once V, the voltage across the diode becomes about 10 times VT, then you see that it shoots up, okay, and you get a very, very large current here. Now this is something they need to appreciate, that that you know that number V by VT, that ratio is what makes a difference, and that need to be an order of 10 or 20. Now another very, very, very important thing to remember when we look at the value of IS. Now a very common mistake made is about the value of IS. What do you think should be the typical value of IS and why? For a normal diode, let us say a diode which you would use in a lab experiment, what should be the value of IS? I will show you an actual simulation, then we'll see. But before that, nanoamps. Okay, nanoampere for silicon and microampere for germanium. Okay. Now today, by the way, germanium diodes we don't use at all. Okay, so we'll fine. I want to show you the same equation I just kind of calculated, and now and let's see the effect of IS. Then you'll be shocked. You'll be shocked to see this. Okay, so that's why. Now what I have here is a graph where I have used 4 values of IS. Okay, same diode equation. 1 is equal to 10 power minus 6, 10 power minus 9, 10 power minus 12, and 10 power minus 15. Now let's look at 10 power minus 6. Look at a value like 0.6 volts. Okay, at 0.6 volts, this is an amps, mind you. 10,000 amps, 0.6 volts, 10,000 amps. Is there something wrong? So what is wrong? So a 10 power 6 value for IS is what? Good or bad? You should never ever use that value. Okay. This is just, I just plugged in numbers and calculated. You can do it yourself also. Okay. It must be shocking. So you see the effect. Now look at the same 0.6. Let us look at if you use 10 power minus 9, that current is somewhere on the order of something like 20 amps, still amps, but sorry, about 10, roughly 10 amps. Okay. Same 0.6, come down to 10 power minus 12, that current becomes now 10 milliamps. You see how drastically it is, because exponential is dropping. That makes sense. Okay. 0.6 volts, 10 milliamps makes sense. The normal diodes which we have made measurements. So this is why you should always remember IS value never ever come below 10 power minus 12. Okay. The other will be a gross error. So this is something very important. In fact, good diodes would have typically 10 power minus 15. Look, 10 power minus 15, your current is of the order of 0.1 milliamp. The value which we very commonly use is 0.7. Look, let us look at 0.7. At 0.7, forget about the 10 power minus 6, current goes to huge. But even at 0.7, a 10 power minus 9 value of IS gives you current of the order of 150 amps, okay, which we have never ever seen that kind of current in the lab. Whereas 10 power minus 12 gives you, even that gives you 1 amp. Okay. Now I am sure when you make measurements in the lab, so this simple equation, if you just calculate, it will make sense. Okay. Now you would have seen that when you do a diode experiment in the lab, which diode do you use? What kind of diodes do you have generally? Normal diodes in the lab, what kind of? IN 4001, okay, that is one diode. What diode is that? It's a power diode, okay. It's meant for power supply applications. Now the IN 4001 has 1 amp and 1000 volts PIV, okay, it's meant for power supply application. Now you would see that, I have done measurements and you would be shocked, you will be again doing some measurements in the lab. You would see that in IN 4001, if you make a measurement for 10 milliamps of current, you would see that the forward voltage is hardly 0.3 volt. Now everything is makes sense, okay. It makes sense now. So that is why you do not take 0.7, as a kind of a value which is there, that value itself is an approximation. Some of these things students also need to know. Some of these simple numbers, if you tell this to students, they also understand it, okay, very, very important. And I am sure if you use a signal diode, okay, signal diode is very different from a power diode. Signal diodes, how do they look like typically? They are very, first of all, they will be very small diodes. Sometimes they are kind of glass type they have, okay. I will show you some actual measurements also, we will actually show you some of these measurements also here. And or sometimes you have like a transistor kind of a can type also, SH some number they have, they are all signal diodes. Now those diodes would show you very different characteristics, okay. Now those signal diodes would have typically IS of the order of 10 power minus 12 or minus 15, that range. But 10 power minus 12 is a good number, okay. Do not come below that. If at all you have to come down only for power diodes. And power diodes we very seldom use for such calculations. So this is an extremely important thing to remember, okay. And at least for our own sake, keep this numbers at mind. But tell me why, what is the problem? IS is what? Is the saturation current. But if you actually make a measurement, somebody might say that you actually get much higher current. So the forward region we said, it is only forward bias current, but the reverse region, reverse bias in the same equation, you would see that the first time when again your V becomes negative, your that e to the power minus V by Vt becomes a almost close to 0, okay. Now we see that I is approximately equal to minus Is, okay. So that is why this is significant, those two terms, which actually is very, very interesting. But if you actually make a measurement in the lab, what do you think you will get? Just take a diode and measure, okay, and you would be shocked that even if you have a diode with IS is equal to 10 power minus 12, if you make a measurement in the lab, you will not get it anywhere there. So 10 power minus 6 that come to our head because of this. Make a measurement, you will get typically 10 power minus 6 or 10 power minus 10. What are the, where is the culprit? What is the problem? Why? Why do you see that? Why do you get a much higher current? So that is why this 10 power 6 is there in our mind, because we have seen it. Why? Now the problem is the following. IS is something highly purely at the device level. But actually when you make a measurement, there is another current called the leakage current. Okay. In a real diode, you have a much higher reverse current. The main reason is because you have leakage effects. And this leakage current is directly proportional to the area. Okay, area of the diode. So therefore, and unfortunately, the strictly speaking, reverse bias should be what? Is a constant, which means supposed to have a flat line. But as you make a measurement, you will see that what do you actually see? If you make a measurement, in fact, it is very difficult to make this measurement. Why is it very difficult? Because the kind of impedance, the meter, multimeter or whatever it is, if you make a measurement with a multimeter, you will make error, okay. You need a much higher impedance for the meter you need, okay. Now the problem here is the leakage current is directly proportional to voltage. So actually what you will see is not this, okay, but you would see a combination of this plus a leakage current which is directly proportional to the voltage, okay. So these are things which are important for us also to realize, that when you actually make a measurement, you would find that the leakage current is much higher than the IS value. So this is why it is very, very important to, and if you are making reverse current measurements, you have to be aware of all this, okay. Otherwise you will make a gross error, gross error. So I hope this is something to think about, okay. And the best thing I would say is to just sit with me this when tomorrow onwards you will be doing labs. When you go to the labs, please make some of these measurements, okay, and see the limitation of a multimeter. Okay, you must see it. What do you think? What is the typical impedance of a multimeter? Input impedance. What is the impedance? Typical?
1 meg.
Any other answers? 10 meg. Any other answers? Typically, all multimeters you buy today would give you at least 20 meg. Okay. 1 meg is somebody else's impedance. Which one? Another instrument which you use for measurements. CRO. CROs are very bad. So, never ever makes measurements, such measurements with a CRO. Never. If you use a voltage probe, a 10:1 voltage probe, then the impedance becomes 10 meg. Okay. So, never ever, in fact, multimeters are much better in making these measurements. Because multimeters would, most of them would give you at least 20 meg. If you have a very sophisticated multimeter, it would give much better than that. Okay. So, this is something very, very, very interesting. Now, when you talk about diode models, I am sure again we do this in the, I am sure you are doing this, and again some insights. Yes, yeah, I am not a device man, but let me, I will try my best. Okay. Now, when you talk about basically when you take a device, you know, you have this minority carriers and majority carriers. IS is the current due to the minority carriers. Now, that is precisely why it is extremely small. Okay. So, that is basically IS itself is highly dependent on the doping of that particular diode. Now, so typically the normal diodes we talk about, the signal diodes we talk about, the doping levels are very, very small. Okay, that is why the currents are very, very small. Whereas in power diodes, because you need much higher currents also, I mean not only doping, the junction areas also is very large in a power diode, much the size also we see that much higher. So, IS actually is a function of many things, one is the doping, one is the area. So, it's a lot of these parameters decide the value of IS. But anyway, for a signal diode, the junction area is extremely small. So, that is another reason why the current for a signal diode is very, very, very small. So, IS is a function of many, many things. Good, it is a good question. See, one very, 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 very good question. I like it. Very good question. See, again, this is another thing we all do in engineering all the time. We talk about models. What are models? A very good question. That is a very good question. It is a very common question, you know, students also face. So, we must be clear first ourselves. Okay. Now, what are models? Why do we use models? What are models? Take for example, Ohm's law. Okay. Is Ohm's law correct? What do you think? I would say, yes or no? It is not completely correct. Yes. When is it correct? When is it wrong? It is correct as long as you make measurements for low voltages and as long as you keep your, you know, the, sorry, sorry. Yeah, see, normal room temperatures, it will work very well. Similarly, if you think about the frequency, okay, you need to keep the frequency also very low. If as you keep increasing frequency and temperature also to some extent, you would see that Ohm's law fails. Okay. So, then why do we use Ohm's law? Why I am asking this question is to bring the issue of models. Why do we use models? Why do we need models? Why do we use Ohm's law? It is a model. It is a model, it is a way of finding, given a resistance, how do I find current. So, it is a model. Now, every model has some assumptions and some limitations. Okay. So, when you talk about a diode and when you say IS, okay, that is a current which flows when you apply a voltage. There is nothing sitting inside. In fact, a diode is a passive device. What is the meaning of a passive device? It has nothing inside, okay, as opposed to a battery or something. Now, strictly when you actually when you apply a voltage there, like if you apply a forward voltage, you have forward a current flowing there due to the majority carriers. So, you have a much larger current. Similarly, when you apply a reverse bias, what is happening is essentially in one sense, you see Ohm's law, strictly speaking, is not valid there, okay. Maybe for some very limited range, Ohm's law will work. So, what is happening is you have a semiconductor material, okay, which actually you cannot directly model as a resistance. But the point is IS, therefore, if you look at the there is an expression for, you can actually write an expression for IS in terms of the doping and area, okay. There are standard equations are available, but so the point is this particular IS is applicable only when you apply a voltage, there is nothing sitting inside. So, it is something which you physically relate to, and actually you can mod. So, that way what I am trying to say is when you write an equation like this, this equation was written by Shockley, okay, a very famous person and one of the persons involved in design of like invention of transistor also. Now, this is something they observed, and then they try to relate, okay, and the diodes which they used were point contact diodes, not the junction diode, because the technology was not well developed in the early 40s, okay. So, they observed some of these effects and they found a model and they found it to be working. Is clear? Okay. Yeah, and by the way, brings to another very important issue. When we talk about another very, very, very important thing is the issue of textbooks, okay. And I know one of the most commonly used textbooks in universities is what? Milman and Halkias. If possible, please throw it out of the window, okay. The simple reason is Milman and Halkias is a book I studied when I was an engineering student. I graduated in 1978. This is a book which I used, okay. That is the time it book came. There was no other book available in the whole world that time. It is a very book, good book at that time, but today that is a very bad book. Do you know why? Please do not use that book today. Why? No. Then I would have used it. We should not be biased against Milman and. What is the problem? See, that is a book written with the technology of knowledge of the 60s, okay. If you say that semiconductor industry has not changed since 60, something is wrong. So, you should use one of the current book, one of the best books you can use is Sutter and Smith, okay. Microtron is Indian edition available, cheap, very accurate, precise, and extremely readable. Milman and Halkias is not at all readable, okay. So, if you are all involved in syllabus, please remove Milman and Halkias from the syllabus, okay. You will do a big service to students. This notes will be available to you. Sutter and Smith, I wanted to bring that book, I will bring you this book and show you. This is called Microelectronic Circuits by Sedra and Smith. It costs about 300 rupees. Thick book, extremely good book. You know, all. In fact, starting from diodes, transistors. No better book I have found even today. Okay, diodes, transistors, op amps. In fact, your not only basic electronics course, your other analog electronics course. This is all that you don't teach anything else. It's too good a book. Okay, and the good thing is it's fifth edition. If a book has five editions, it tells something, okay, and that is a book which followed all over the world, and I have never found a better book, okay. And last semester we used another book here called Bobrow, L.S. Bobrow, again by Oxford University Press, a good book, but that is only one edition, plus and minus, simple book. But I would strongly recommend all of you to, you know, have this Sutter and Smith, because, you know, beautifully tells all this and lots of problems, lots of good problems. This is another very important issue. Now, when we talk about models, okay, again very important to have models. When you have a diode, we have that equation. Now, the purpose of a model, all engineering models, is to be as accurate as possible. But accuracy is not the big issue. What is the big issue in all models? Because this is a very, very important concept, not only for us but for students also. Because all subjects they learn models. Here also we are talking about models. What is the purpose of a model? So, you have an equation, that equation, why are you not happy with that equation? Why do you need a model? The equation is too complex, okay. For an actual application, you would like to have a model which is simple, at the same time really kind of reasonably accurate, okay. Why is accuracy not important, especially in electronic circuit? In our courses, why is it not important? Sorry? Yeah, see, one very important thing you must remember is, that is why again I said Milman and Halkias, you know, I mean it is a book which was written a long time ago when there was nothing available. But today you have extremely good simulation tools available. The purpose of teaching a course is not to get accuracy to this third decimal point, but is to help a student to design or to do a hand calculation. In hand calculation, you are not looking for accuracy, you are looking for a range. So, I always tell students, you must always have the range in mind, not the exact number. Okay. They should know that if current is in 100 amps, something is wrong in a diode. Okay. That they should get. It may be within 10 milliamp, 20, that milliamp, microamp, the range is very, very important. Okay. Accuracy, you have a plenty of free simulation tools which they could use. Okay. So, when you talk about exponential model, this is directly picked up from the Shockley equation, therefore, it will be very accurate. But what will be the problem? What is the problem? This is never used, but it is very accurate. What is the problem? Too complicated. For example, you have a simple circuit like this. Now, you apply a voltage, find the current and the voltage. You have one equation, two unknowns. Okay. Now, you somebody might say that this can be solved either graphically or iteratively, but fortunate thing is just by writing two or three equations, you can write two equations, one for the current. This is the being forward, because of the forward biased, you can write just the simpler one, and the second equation is because you write a symbol, you know, Ohm's law, if you apply, you can write it. If you iteratively solve this, you will get extremely good accuracy. So, in two iterations, I have done the iteration here, iteration number 1, you assume the Vd to be 0, which will give you an Id value of battery divided by the resistance 5 milliamps. Now, put that back into the previous equation. Now, you find out what is Vd, which will give you 558.3 millivolt. Second iteration, take that value, plug in here, find the new value of Id, and you get 4.44 milliamps. Plug it back here, find the thing, and you see it has converged just in two steps. So, a simple iterative method with simple calculator is all that you need, but still this is too complex. So, because of this, this is not used at all. Okay. And most of the diode circuits, you do not need this kind of accuracy, you do not need it. So, this is very important when you talk about models. What is important is, so when you talk about, we have at least 3 more models. The piecewise linear model, this is again reasonably good accuracy, a constant voltage drop model, where you just take the diode to be just a voltage. Okay. And you also have an ideal model, which is the simplest one. Now, the piecewise linear model, essentially what you have is, you assume the diode to be a ideal diode and in series with a kind of a battery and a RD. Now, the most important thing to remember here is, again, is that there is no battery sitting here. You have a voltage source. So, the current is flowing what? Into the battery, which means it only can dissipate power. So, this is very important in a model, because this is a very common doubt. Okay, you have a battery sitting there. Is it delivering power? No. It is only a representation, it can only dissipate power, it cannot give power. Okay. So, it is only an equivalent circuit. So, this is a model, that is the important thing to remember about models. Models are made for our convenience and they always have limitations and they have to be used within those assumptions, not outside that. Now, I have just I plugged in the piecewise linear model and the exact diode equation, and you can see that pretty good approximation. Okay. But again, what is the problem? Even this is most of the time too complex. Okay. Most of the problems in a diode problem, this is not, but this is very, very good. You will get results very close to what you actually observe. So, this, if you want accuracy, then you should go for piecewise linear. Now, the issue is, here I have used the series resistance as 10 ohms. Should it be 5 ohms, should it be 15 ohms, that depends. Depends on the kind of current at the operating point you want. So, this is where you may have, if you want a lot of accuracy, you may have to play with it. Yeah, the constant voltage model is kind of very, very commonly used, and all that you are saying is, you assume that the diode does not conduct up to some voltage. So, up to 0.7 it does not conduct, and all of a sudden you have infinite current. Okay. It looks very, very, very idealistic, but this is a very, very good model. Okay. Especially when you talk about clipping circuits, you do not want lot of complexity. So, this is a good model. Okay. And because of this, the output result which you are going to get will not be very accurate, but that is fine. If you are not satisfied with accuracy, you can first use this and then go back to the previous one. So, very often, and this is a skill we also need to pass on to the students, that given a circuit, they should learn skills to divide and conquer. Okay. They should know how to, and that is skill they have to learn. So that's where when looking at a circuit, they should be able to figure out forward bias, road bias, which one do I remove, this or that. That skill they have to develop. So this kind of a model is very useful just to see what is happening in the circuit. Once I understand that, then I can figure out what to do next. Yeah, the ideal diode model again is very, very often used. This is especially used when you are talking about the voltage drop across the diode, 0.6 to 0.8 volt being negligible, like in a power supply circuit. Your transformer may be 12 sin omega t, huge. So 0.6 volt is something you do not want to bother about it. So such cases you would just ignore. Yeah. Now coming back to diode applications, let us quickly go through a few applications. Now rectifier application is the most common application. Now, I would strongly, and I do not know how much flexibility you have in your curriculum or how much your college will be happy about it or unhappy about it if you give some small projects to students. But something which is extremely good today, if some students can make a simple power supply, okay, maybe in groups, okay, the amount of learning they will go through is tremendous. Because they get to see a transformer, they get to understand some understanding of electric engineering, they see a transformer, they see the voltage, they see the connection between peak voltage and RMS voltage, all these confusions are done. So nothing to beat an experiment. So I think it is a good idea. I do not know because unfortunately one of the biggest problem even in IITs we face is when we get our M.Tech students, a good number of those students have never ever experimented. At least but I am assuming all of you are from very good institutions, I am sure that is not a problem, definitely at your place. But many colleges, I am sure you may be aware of such colleges, experiments are rigged up and kept there. Students are asked to take what? Take readings, okay. That is the silliest thing that can happen, okay. No student will ever learn anything if you do that. And we get into our M.Tech good students who have come from that background, and we have to teach them all basic electronics, okay, before they are of any use to us. So please remember, and especially electronics is a course, fortunately you can do a simple, as I said, all that you need is a multimeter, an oscilloscope, sometimes even oscilloscope is not required, a multimeter is all that you need, a multimeter, a power supply and a functionator. You can teach the entire basic electronics just with that, and the amount of learning students go through. Why I am saying this, because when you find the kind of basic questions students have even after graduation, electronic students, then you are amazed something is wrong. So I think you have a very big role to play, and that is where I think we need your feedback also, what are the things where we should emphasize, then accordingly in especially for the June the lectures, then those issues we could take care. So we need a lot of feedback from you. Yeah, so this is a clipping circuit, you will be doing some of this in the lab. Now how do you analyze this kind of a circuit, any circuit? So and before we actually I've given a solution there, but anyway, the most important thing whenever you get a circuit like this from the point of view of a student is to figure out what is happening in the diode more than what is the result, okay. First he has to figure out how the diode is connected. Now the diode is connected in this fashion, which means that for the positive half diode will be off, okay, which means this is an open circuit, okay. So this can be, let us say, a divide and conquer strategy is what we do always do in engineering, okay. So that entire branch can be removed for the positive half, and that becomes a very, very simple resistive network. So you get output will be 0.75 of input, very, very simple. Now the reverse, what happens? Again, because this battery connected in series here, till this branch, the voltage across this particular branch has to exceed 3 volt, then only. So some of these basic things if you understand, then it can be solved. So I think that is very, very, very important, this kind of circuits here, so which I have given here. I am sure you have done this kind of thing, and what I have done here is I just done the same thing, simulated it and see how it look like. So this is the input here and this is the output look like. Yeah. Now yeah, coming back to, so diodes, as I said, you know, something which students really understand well, and it is basically there are not many conceptual problems there, but when you come to Zener diode, yes, that is where a lot of problems students have, lot of problems. Why reverse, why positive, why negative, lot of confusions. So this is where we need to really emphasize, again as I said, an experiment is something which is very, very, very useful. So Zener diodes are primarily reference diodes and used in as voltage regulators, and typically the sinner voltage would maybe anywhere from a few volts to a few hundreds of volts. Now today especially lot of these things you can relate to their charger, mobile charger in their hand, okay. And again, if you can ask students to maybe design a simple voltage regulator or something, it'll not, you are not worried about the actual output of what they got, but more than that, the process they gone through. And only if they burn a few components, they learn something, okay. And only thing, it should be a measured, it should not be, the lab should not burn, okay. Maybe a component can burn, yeah. So again, a simple sinner regulator, because again, a sinner, when you model it, you have to model both the positive forward bias region and the reverse bias region, okay. And those two resistances will be very different. We'll see that. We'll show you. Okay, I'll just show you an actual measurement of a sinner diode. Yeah. So what I have done is we have connected a actual measurement. Now this is using LabVIEW, which is a very good software, but unfortunately, as Professor Kannan rightly said, for education institution is very cheap. You get a 4 lakh license for about 100 users, but still it is a costly. But the good thing about LabVIEW is very easy to do things, a lot of things can be done easily. Now what we have done is we have connected a sinner diode and the characteristics. Let us see the characteristics, let us run it and see. Let us hope it works. Yeah, so you can see this is a sinner. Yeah, so this is nice to see. See, you can see this is a sinner diode. Now, very important thing to remember in a sinner diode is the forward region is exactly like a normal diode. And the look at the slope, this slope and this slope. What is the main difference here? If you model this, which one has more resistance, forward region or reverse resistance? Reverse, okay. So this is very, very important, and this tells you a lot about a sinner. In a sinner diode, it is extremely important that the voltage which you mentioned there is mentioned for a current, okay. So you can see here, depending on the current, like for example, if you are talking about 1 milliamp, minus 1 milliamp, the corresponding voltage is around minus 2.8 volts, okay. But depending on that particular current here, you can get different values. So now putting it back, if you want a extremely accurate value of voltage in a sinner diode, what should you do? Sorry?
No.
Listen to my question again. Look at the graph. Sinner diodes are used all over the world for as voltage regulators, okay. Now if I want to get an extremely constant sinner voltage, what should I do? Then I design my circuit. What should I do? Just looking at the graph. What's the name? No, positive I can't use, you know, because sinner sees positive. No. My question is, what should I do? What should I do? Sorry? No. I have no liberty. Somebody has bought me a sinner. I have to use it. That's fine. I am talking only about this. My question is, where should I operate? Now, what should I do?
I should operate in the reverse bias.
Yes, that is taken for granted. But then,
after a particular current limit is exceeded.
Yeah, but you are all missing one big point. See, the important thing is, if you want, I told you something. I want very good accuracy. So, what should I do?
Resistance.
I can't do anything. That's a given to me, no? Can't change the diode. It has something to do with the current.
Operate
at a constant current. That word I was looking for, nobody said it. Okay. So that is the important thing. So if you want a very accurate sinner voltage, see the exact voltage is not very important. Once I have a fixed voltage, I can do whatever I want. To do that, that is what this graph says here. Okay. This graph is telling is, if I pass 1 milliamp current through this, I get some voltage. So I must have a constant current source passing only 1 milliamp. Okay. Of course, it has to be in the reverse region. Then I get that voltage, which is steady. Okay. And another very interesting thing about sinner is, any other property of sinner as opposed to normal diodes? We will put a diode also and show you. Okay. Another diode. This is a sinner diode. Any Anything else interesting about it? See, a normal diode has a, another, today is a very, very, very important use of a normal diode. One is rectifier, we said clipper, clamper, anything else? Silicon simple diode has a very big use today. Sorry? Good, very good. Temperature, temperature sensor. It's an extremely good temperature sensor. Now, how is it used? Again, same thing. If you pass a constant current through a silicon diode, okay, for every degree rise in temperature, the junction voltage will decrease by exactly 2 millivolt. You may be aware of an IC called LM35. LM35 just uses it, but only one difference. The output will be exactly 10 millivolt per degree centigrade. They linearized it. That's all they have done. So all they have to do is a three-terminal device, connect any voltage to the input, output will be exactly 10 millivolt into your degree centigrade. So if it gives you 290 millivolt, 29 degree centigrade. It is very commonly available, 20 rupees, but it's a fantastic thing, okay, extremely good thing. All that it does is, it has a constant current source, pass that through a diode and just take the voltage across it, amplify it and linearize it, that is all he has done, okay, all based on this principle. So this is a very, very, very simple, though simple, a very good thing. So we have put a normal diode, let's now use a, see how a normal diode characteristics will look like. Ah, yeah, reverse region, no current, and then it shoots up. Okay, so this is a normal diode. Again, you can see the forward characteristics of this and the previous zener diode were what? Similar. Another important thing is, look at the voltage. Forward voltage is how much? This is a silicon diode. How much? Roughly around 0.6, 0.7. Okay, based on that previous IS value, what do you think? If you guess back, what may be the IS value? 10 power minus 12, somewhere between 10 power minus 12 and 10 power minus 15. Okay, that's very, very evident here. Okay, so this one thing. Now, one more thing before I disconnect it. Can you connect an LED? LED. Now, there are a few more types of special diodes. We'll talk about them. One such special diode is an LED. I'll put it up right now. Now, the most common problem. If you any idea what if you do the measurement of an LED, how that will be different compared to this? Okay, good. Now the cut-in voltage may not be that high, but you are right. Sometimes can be 2 plus, but it will be definitely more than 1.5 volts. Okay, depending on the type of LED, you will never be 0.7. That's the most important thing to do. But unfortunately, this number 0.7 has got stuck into our head. Okay, and we have to get out of it. And that 0.7 or that voltage is kind of, it depends on the material use. If it is germanium, is 0.2. If it is gallium arsenide and gallium phosphate, that kind of material, you have different values. Okay. So we'll do an experiment right now. This is a LED. Yeah, same reverse characteristic, but look for the forward characteristics. Can you see? It's somewhere around 0.1. That if you expand that, you can see that around 1.8. Okay, very different from the previous one. So this is something very, very important to remember about an LED. The forward voltage is quite high, somewhere around 1.8. It can even be greater than 2, depending on the material. Especially if you use a blue LED, it will be greater. Depends on the material. They are all different materials, and LEDs. LEDs are made of all diodes which are used in the lab, the power diodes or the signal diodes, they are all most of the time made of silicon. Okay. Now, as a material, silicon is a indirect band gap material. Okay. Whenever you inject carriers, there is always recombination taking place. Okay. When, for example, electrons are injected into the let us say P region, there is recombination taking place all the time. Now, recombination can, when recombination takes place, you are actually giving out energy. It can be give out either radiatively or non-radiatively. Okay. In a silicon, the chance of having a radiative recombination is negligible. Whereas, if you have special semiconductors like direct semiconductors, which are, one example is gallium arsenide. Now, such as most of the 3-5 semiconductors come in that category, gallium arsenide, aluminum gallium arsenide, indium gallium arsenide, all these are direct band gap materials. In these materials, if you make a diode out of these materials, whenever you pass a forward current, it will emit light, because the recombination that takes place has at least 50% of, it will be radiative recombination. and the remaining 50 may be non radiating. So, LED, the principle of an LED is just to have a PN junction made of direct band gap semiconductors, and depending on the material you get different colors. Okay, that is the principle of an LED. Now, let me go down. We are talking about other diodes. Now, another LED, we just now talked about it. Now, LED is an extremely interesting, again this is something you could enthuse students. The cost of an LED is only 50 paisa today, very cheap, but the kind of things you can do with an LED is amazing. Okay, we will talk about one such thing. Now, LED is also called an electro-optic converter. It can convert the electrical current into an optical signal. In fact, LED, if you look at the light output, you would see that the light output is directly proportional to the current flowing through it. So, it is used in fiber optic communication as a source. Now, let us look at photodetectors. I have a purpose in discussing photodetectors now. Now, photodetectors, LED is always used in which bias? Forward bias. It is very important to remember. Now, photodetectors on the other way, they are always used in reverse bias. Now, again, any radiation, being a semiconductor, semiconductors have a problem, because any radiation, especially heat, okay, would increase the number of carriers. Now, in a forward bias condition, if you put some heat, the effect of that excess carriers is negligible, but if it is reverse bias, the current is very small. Now, if you put any radiation, okay, especially if you open the junction area, put some radiation, light or anything, you would see that the current shoots up, okay, very high. Now, the principle of photodetector is nothing but this. All that is done in a photodetector is you make a large depletion region, okay, make that large so that most of the light falling on it falls in the depletion region. Now, what happens is the number of carriers will shoot up. So, in a photodetector, and most of the time the visible light you can get, you can use a silicon for that purpose. Now, in a the current which is flowing, because it is a reverse junction, there is no light, it will be nothing but our reverse saturation current. And as I said earlier, even though the reverse saturation current IS may be 10 power minus 15, but because of the leakage current, typically the best you can get rather will be about 1 nanoamp, you cannot get less than that. Okay. Most of the diodes, so in a photodiode also, the typical current, the reverse current is about 1 nanoamp, and that current has a name. What is the name of the current? Dark current, intentionally done to say that that is a current flowing when there is no light. And when light flows, you have what is called a photocurrent. Now, you can think of another very interesting thing about a photodetector is, because it is used in the reverse bias mode, you can think of this like a current source. Okay. And if you model it, it has to be modeled as a current source, as opposed to a diode, where it has to be modeled as a voltage source. You saw that all diodes are, whereas here, a photodetector, you have to model it as a current source. Because what is the property of a current source? How do you model a current source? Which model would you use? Thevenin model or Norton model? Norton model. So, Norton model, you have a current source and a parallel resistance, and that resistance is ideally infinite. Okay. So, here a photodetector you can think of as a controlled current source with a resistance in parallel. Now, a beautiful device can be made out of a LED and a photodetector, called optocoupler. Now, this is something all non-electrical students must see, okay, or you should tell them. Now, optocouplers are extensively used. Now, the biggest use of optocoupler is if you want to transmit a signal from one system to another system without interconnecting them. What is the problem if you connect two systems together? If you wire, what is the problem? Impedance. Let me ask a simple question. Very often, you know, you try to take your laptop somewhere and you want to print or something, most people are scared to connect. Why? See, what happens is, one very common mistake we all make is about ground. What is ground? What is the definition of ground? Let me ask a question. For an aeroplane, where is ground? Which is ground for an aeroplane? It's body. What about a car? Chassis. Okay. So, the point is, reference ground is nothing but a reference point. Now, because of the same thing, two systems you bring together, the chances of having exactly the same ground is almost, you know, zero. This is extremely dangerous. Now, if you connect two systems with two reference points and short them together, what will happen? Okay, sometimes you can have fire also. Okay, now this is where if you have, you are talking about a high voltage system, and if you want to connect that to another system through a wire, you can have disaster. So in most such applications you would use optocoupler. Optocoupler, that's the beauty of optocoupler. You don't have to connect. Okay, you have a electrical isolation. All that you do is you put your signal here, this light shines. Other end you pick it up. So both are sitting at their own ground levels without any problem. It's extremely useful and a very very interesting device, optocouplers. Okay, so especially non-electrical students must see this. Why? Especially mechanical engineers, you would, they would burn a few things. Okay, just because of this, ground is such a complicated concept, and a lot of things are burnt just because they don't understand what ground is. Okay, now laser diodes. My specialization is optical fiber communication. I deal with this all the time. Now, laser diodes are nothing but, let's say, special LEDs, where the they are fabricated in such a way that the light coming out is coherent. So that's not, but you can think of them as, let's say, special LEDs. And today, laser diodes are used extensively in all communications they use. But more than that, pointers. Okay, we are all familiar with the standard the kind of laser pointers. Okay, any idea what is the kind of power you're seeing here? In fact, if you read it, they'll say, why do they sell this? In fact, what is the power of, let's say, a tube light, to standard tube light? 40 watts. Any idea what's power here? 500 microwatt maximum. Yeah, I don't think it's even that. Okay, why is it look so bright, whereas the light 40 watt? 500 microwatt looks so bright, but the 40 watt doesn't look that bright. Why? Coherence. So this is where it is coherence. You have two types of coherence. One is what is called a spatial coherence, which means it's so sharp, focused. Okay, so that's an angular or spatial. So it's extremely narrow beam. Whereas the tube light, it spreads all over the place. So there is no spatial coherence. Number one. Second thing is what is called a temporal coherence or the spectral coherence. If you look at this light, it looks so sharp, red. If you see the spectrum of it, you would see that you have a extremely narrow, you know, wavelength region. So that is called the temporal coherence. So a laser diode, LED also does that, but LED is much broader than a laser diode. So let's not get into that. But anyway, before we have crossed the time, solar cells. And just let me just stop with this varectors. Now again, another very good thing you can tell students is about varectors. Like I am sure all students would have done, you know, fine tuning, you know. And so if you say that varectors are special diodes which are used in the reverse bias, where if you change the voltage, the capacitance of changes in a very small, maybe in the sub picofarad range, which you cannot change otherwise, you can change the tuning, and then they really understand. So I think we'll stop here. So it's a very broad kind of subject. We talked a lot of things. The diodes, as you said, is a topic well understood, and a lot of applications, and conceptually students find this not that difficult. Yeah, thank you.